Ham Radio Now, episode 120. Just wait for me. 121. Okay, go. And we are at the Tapper Digital Communications Conference, getting deeper into Saturday. We're going to take a look at a talk by John Ronan, EI7IG, from Ireland. That is Ireland, right? EI7. John is involved in their equivalent of ARES, the Emergency Service, Civil Defense, I think he called it over there, and likes to experiment and set up radio systems that will do a good job for emergency communications. And what he's been working on the past year is trying to use D-STAR, and this is the high-speed 1200 megahertz version of D-STAR, to rapidly send messages across a pretty big county, a territory that is difficult to get RF across, especially maybe on 1200 megahertz. And he's trying to figure out the best ways to be able to do that. And he's got these things called OSLR and B.A.T.M.A.N. And tell you what, I'm going to let him explain what that's all about and show you the experimenting that he's been doing over the past year. And he's still working on it. So we'll get to that in just a moment. As usual, I need to say thanks to the hams who helped me get out to Seattle and record the conference and get back here and start editing it. About 115 hams with half of the contributions that it took to get out there. In addition to you guys, there's Flex Radio Systems. And we've been talking about the 6000 series, the 6500 and 6700 software-defined radios, which are, you know, they're moderately high-priced, not the highest-priced radios that you can buy in ham radio, but they're, you know, they're up there. Not maybe the first radios you're going to consider if you're just getting into ham radio. So they've also still got their earlier models, the 3000 series and the 1500, a little bit more affordable. So if software-defined radio is something you want to get into, stop by flexradio.com. And check them out. Then there's Tapper themselves, you know, the folks that are putting on the DCC. And I thought I would show this page that I haven't looked at before. This is a list of all the mailing lists that Tapper sponsors. And these aren't on Yahoo or Google groups. They are their own systems. So if any of those groups look good to you, you might want to stop by Tapper at their website, tapr.org, and check them out. And hopefully join Tapper. And finally, there's Elecraft. And I want to point out briefly this K-Line thing. I think they realized that they had a group of radios that could all look pretty good together. And somebody pointed out, well, that's kind of like the old Collins S-Line. So you could call it the K-Line. So they do. And Elecraft gets the longer announcement for this episode. So let's go look at my pre-recorded Elecraft pitch. Elecraft has built their way up to a pretty wide variety of radios and peripherals. Their flagship radios are the K3 and KX3 transceivers. The K3 is a software-defined radio under the hood, but it comes disguised as a conventional radio with all the knobs, dials, buttons, and displays you'd expect in a full-featured HF radio. And I say HF, but it includes 6 meters and even 2 meters with an optional transverter, and that fits right inside the case. You can get it either as a kit, that would be a no-soldering kit, or fully assembled, and either a 10-watt or 100-watt transmitter. And it's modular, so you can start simple and add the extra pieces to build up the radio later. Some more of those extras include a sub-receiver, an automatic antenna tuner, and a digital voice recorder. And I guess I should mention that the receiver features extremely high-performance specs. A very cute feature of the K3 is the ability to decode RDI and PSK31 and display the text scrolling across the screen and send those digital modes using a keyer paddle to generate the letters.
So we're actually sending RTTY right now, even though you hear it as CW on the keyer paddle.
Okay, you got to know CW to do that because you're keying in your text in Morse code characters. That's just a little bit about the K3, so stop by the Elecraft website, elecraft.com. for more details. And the KX3 is a unique little radio. It's a 10-watt HF plus 6-meter and optional 2-meter radio that looks like a control head for a more conventional mobile radio. But that's the whole thing. And there's room inside for 8 AA batteries to make it a complete standalone QRP station. Okay, you do need to add an antenna. It also does RDI and PSK31 right inside the radio, scrolling the text on the display, and the keyer paddle that inputs the text bolts right on the bottom of the case. Yes, you can also use the paddle to send real CW, and I get the impression that Elecraft is subtly encouraging you to learn Morse code. The KX3's got a pretty darn good receiver, maybe not quite as good as the K3, but way better than you might expect in this little box, including 32-bit DSP, and you can update the firmware with a PC. Elecraft has a nifty 100-watt amp to make it pretty much a full-power, full-featured HF rig, if you must. And again, I've just scratched the surface. Okay, maybe a deep scratch, but there's lots more to learn. I'll round this out with a quick mention of some of the other Elecraft products. There's the P3 PAN adapter, 200 kilohertz wide for now, but wider is coming, and more features than I can talk about for now. The real-time internet remote for the K3, a 500-watt solid-state amp, a high-power auto-tuner, the K2 is still around, the cute KX1 ultra-portable CW transceiver, and the K1 is still around too. All right, you got to go to their website to see more. All of Elecraft's products are sold directly from their website worldwide, so stop by elecraft.com. Thanks again to Elecraft, to Tapper, Flex Radio, and you guys too. Let's get down to Seattle. I mean, over to Seattle. And Steve Bible, if you'd bail me out here and introduce John Ronan.
Okay, I'd like to introduce John Ronan. John... EI7IG. Sorry, John, you don't get the most traveled award this year. That goes to Finland. But we're really glad you're here. And he would like to talk about evaluating OSLR and B.A.T.M.A.N. over D-STAR.
Morning, everyone. If it appears I'm surprised when I look at the slides as they appear, it's because I am. I haven't seen them in 3 weeks. I've been on vacation. Myself and my wife have been in the States for about 3 weeks. Basically, the two protocols we're looking at are OSLR and B.A.T.M.A.N. I don't know if you're familiar with the story, or I'm not sure if the story is told here, where two guys, or a guy pulls up in a village somewhere and asks for directions, and the guy looks at him and says, well, if I was going there, I wouldn't start from here. This isn't the paper I intended to write. Basically, what I intended to do was a very simple, or so I thought, review of OSLR in use in an environment where there's some fixed nodes, one or two mobile nodes, and it's to basically give internet connectivity of some sort, for most likely email, to the mobile node. So I started with OSLR, and I ended up using B.A.T.M.A.N. I ran out of time. There are other protocols out there which I would probably come back to in the future. I have access to four ID1s. That's why I use them. At my own house, I have a DSL connection, so the default route is through those. And the idea was to see how fast and how useful the connectivity would be from a mobile node. When I went looking at them, OSLR was the obvious choice. It's well covered in the literature. There's lots of papers about it, lots of papers how to tweak it. I thought, how bad can it be? OSLR itself, it's defined by the ITF. It does lots of messaging between nodes for various things. There's no need to go through them in detail here, but there's quite a lot of them. They have a specific purpose, and basically OSLR is very chatty. This has a huge impact on the connection. The RFC defines the default settings as hello messages every 2 seconds, traffic control every 5, MIDs and HNAs the same as TC. Straight off the bat, that doesn't work. Right, it doesn't work on a low-banded network. So I thought I'd be reasonable. I did, some control tests and a point-to-point link, and then I went through one hop. So the whole mobile thing got dropped immediately. because I did a drive-by. I'll show you some slides in a second, just a drive around the area. And I realized I needed to characterize what's the best I can get out of this before I decide to go mobile and try use mobile from mobile stations. So I used several different settings. I used 2 seconds for the hello message, 10 seconds, 30 seconds. And that allowed me to do the same with Batman afterwards. Batman came out of perceived inadequacies, well, some would say they are inadequacies of OSLR. It's really only interested in the best hop, best next hop to the destination. It's specifically designed for unreliable links, and it just uses one message, basically, an originator message, which contains the IP of the originator, address of the node transmitting, TTL and a sequence number. Pretty simple. Its default is 1 second. That doesn't work either, by the way. So I use 2 seconds, 10, 30, the same as OSLR. So I kind of wear two hats. My interest in this is primarily emergency communications support. I'm involved in ARIN, which is the equivalent of ARIES here in the States. So I'm involved in ARIN in Ireland, but I'm also involved in civil defense organization. It's called civil defense. It still exists in Hawaii, I think. So the primary responsibilities of civil defense are, it exists in law. The organization itself exists in law. It answers to the Department of Defense. It answers to the local authority as a reporting structure. It's all volunteers who are trained in auxiliary fire service, comms, welfare. There used to be a warden service, i.e. radiological checking. We're close to the UK. They've got a couple of nuclear power stations. Paranoia in the Cold War, that's where it came from. And this is casualty service. So my officer, my CDO, one of his things is he spent time with the Red Cross in Sarajevo. And he had on his team some radio guys, as he knew them at the time. And they were able to do quite a lot for him as regards getting information in and out of the area. So one of his things is comms in and out of the area. For us, there's a local airport. We do lots of, duties in remote areas. So he understands the value of comms, he understands the value of digital comms, and that's kind of where the impetus for this came from. So these two slides, I live down about here, or actually about there. The other station involved in the experiments, he's in there. So this was what I did here was I did a very simple small script, laptop, GPS, and did a war drive effectively. Two nodes were the node in my place here, and the node in Nikki's place, EA3JB, is up here. I'll just zoom in a second. But basically, the red dots are where I got a ping response. So very simple script, record the position, send a ping to both nodes, get a response. So you can see in this one, Nikki's place is about there. You can see all around Waterford City, and this is quite a high part of the road across here. If you don't recognize this, this is Exaster, and it's using the OpenStreetMap maps. So some responses here, some along the road here. This road here is actually covered by trees both sides. It's like an old country house avenue. It's a big wide road, big high trees, and as you can see, it kills the RF quite well. In around here, it's around the city. Nikki's house can see most of this. So that was, say, one node. And this is from my place. As you can see, around Tremor itself, it's not so bad. In along this road here, and there's one or two packets up around here. So the idea was, if these nodes are on a mesh, how well a mobile node could use them for internet connectivity. That was the theory. I never got that far. This is my experimental network, really. So it's deliberately set up that the nodes at two ends can't see one another. It's deliberately creating the hidden node problem here. It is the worst case Well, it's not the worst, but with three nodes, it pretty much is. If the two ends can't hear one another, you're going to get mutual interference. They will basically stand on one another. So Nikki's place, my place, we actually do have line of sight. One watt with on an ICOM ID1 is perfect. We can get a perfect, pretty much zero loss. Again, the same 100 milliseconds round trip time that the guys yesterday saw. And then what I did was, the second node is basically a mag mount antenna slapped on the side of a press in my house so that it can't hear this node up here. There's a lot more detail in the paper on that, how we run it. We had a long discussion with Brian last night, which went on far too late, actually. But I don't think I made it clear in the paper. What I tend to do for practical and, I suppose, other reasons, run a test for 5 minutes, do five of those, take an average, and I've been using that as a way of doing tests for quite a long time. I'm not saying it's perfect, but it tends to give. So on these tests, a full test run takes about an hour on a point-to-point link. So when you start getting into a single hop with, say, a hello of 30, that test will take about 2 hours to do a full run. Why a five-minute interval to start with? Well, that's long enough for me to make a cup of tea. It's quite simple. I can get out, make a cup of tea, come back, and just make sure it's still running for the next test. So this is OSLR. The yellow isn't OSLR. This is basically the control. This is a single hop. I left out the graphs of the, say, point-to-point link. If you look in the paper, you'll see they look pretty good. It all works pretty well in the point-to-point link because there's nothing there to do any interfering. So this graph, this is basically min, max, and average. Quite simple. But this is static routing. Routing configured statically. Don't override IPv4. That's roughly what I got. About 33, I think, kilobytes a second. Using iPerf here, it's not perfect. iPerf isn't perfect, but it is a tool. It's around a while. It's easy to script with. So that's what I used for all these tests. So it's a 300-second, 5-minute interval. Run a test in a loop. Do it again. And then get your average. So this is the static one. Static routing, about 33K. That's the best case I'm going to get over that link using IP. So I went to a hello of 2. So the standard RFC-defined hello interval, the throughput, as you can see, is an overnight run. Start it up, get up tomorrow, and it might be finished. It actually, on that one, and the same for the OGM of 1 second, I actually got hugely frustrated. Effectively what would happen was, and it happened much more frequently to OSLR, in that it was not able to get its own routing packets, hello messages out, and effectively the routing would collapse. And it just could not work in that environment with the hello interval of 2. This is of 10. It gets better in the relay. Now this is actually, this is also a one-way iPerf, so it's a single directional. So I'm just chucking data at the far end. I was doing it from the node in my house, the mag mount in my house, through the node in my house to Nikki's place. And I had connectivity, I was able to log into Nikki's machine and set things up beforehand, etc. So basically, there's the hello of 10 and hello of 30. As you can see, it's not very useful. It drops to under 10K for both. Slightly surprising is when you go to bidirectional. So if you tell iPerf to run two simultaneous, so it's trying to do both directions at the same time. As you can see, even static routing, the aggregate, basically if you sum the two, the both directions simultaneously, the aggregate throughput or goodput goes up. So it goes up slightly for the static routing. All of a sudden, the 2 second hello interval is actually somewhat better, and 10 and 30. Now, I can't explain this one. I'm going to have to go back and look at the TCP dumps. I have theories, and Darren, my co-author, has some theories as to why this happens, but we don't actually know. And it was he suggested the bidirectional test because he saw some similar. He has worked on some military stuff in the UK and doing some tests on some of their gear. He got similar results sometime in the past, and he was curious to see what had happened here, because the bandwidths and the equipment type, I'm not going to give anything away, were quite similar to what the ID1s are capable of. Batman, which is the other one I tried, if you look at the average here, again, there's the static. No routing protocol involved. The default, you can just see there is actually some throughput there. That's 2 days. Started running, come back in 2 days. It's pretty poor. 10 second OGM interval, it's not bad. 30 isn't bad, isn't far from what the average, 30 like is pretty good. And again, the bidirectional one is behaves slightly different again. So maybe I should explain it properly. With iPerf, you can tell it, set up a stream running in away from, so basically one direction, and at the same time or shortly thereafter, set up one coming back. Quite often in the OSLR tests, the second one wouldn't actually establish. So I had to run an awful lot more than just five runs. But the aggregate in this one has also gone up. This is something in TCP. I don't quite understand it. I will have to come back to it at some point in the future. But it's an interesting result nonetheless. Now, it could be due to the specific scenario where I've contrived to have a hidden node. Basically, the two endpoints can't see one another at all. They don't see one another on RF. Never mind. So they don't get a sniff of one another on RF. So when you stick them all on one graph, there's your static. Hello of 2, OGM of 2, hello of 10, OGM of 10, hello of 30, OGM of 30. And the obvious thing there is, if you're going to try and do mesh with D-Star, well, the obvious thing from these results is if you want to do mesh with D-Star, don't use OLSR. Right? Why did I look at OLSR in the first place? It's used by the HSM and mesh guys. It seemed like a good place to start. I've done work with OLSR in the past on Wi-Fi networks. It works reasonably well there. D-Star DD mode doesn't have the bandwidth to deal with the chattiness of OLSR. There's the same graph, just in the bidirectional ones. It's quite similar. Again, Batman is not too far behind static routing. It's usable. It is usable. So a couple of items to note. There's an approximate, so the bidirectional tests show improved overall good put. How significant that is, I don't know, for operational use, because you would tend to be sending flows in one direction, not both at the same time. Unless, I think in Eric's case yesterday, they would have multiple machines doing multiple things. You may have web traffic coming in and mail traffic going out. Of the two links, one link had 40 dB advantage over the other. We just did a rough calculation afterwards. It appears that some of the reason for the bidirectional improved throughput is ACKs tend to get through for some reason of the way TCP is behaving. So ACKs can tend to make it back and then continue the flow from the other side. They can tend to make it through on the disadvantage path better when you're running a stream in their direction. And obviously, less aggressive settings improve the throughput. This has obvious implications for network convergence. So if you switch on a node, you want it to bootstrap and get itself onto the network. Obviously, the longer the interval, the longer it's going to take for the network to converge afterwards. 30 seconds, though, isn't bad. From a civil defense point of view, we're going to be an awful lot longer than 30 seconds getting our gear switched on and getting everything set up. But just from a mobile point of view, I thought that was interesting, and I ran out of time, so I didn't go for any longer tests. or longer intervals. So our future plans. I live here. Nikki lives there. John McCarthy lives here. And we have a node, currently with an APRS node, one link, we have a digipeater here. We used to have an ATV repeater here. And just about the week before I came out, John McCarthy, IHA, said to me he was basically switching off the ATV repeater on the site because no one is using it. So now we have a coax running up a tower, and it seems a shame not to put it in use. So when I get back, we're putting an ID1 up here, and we're going to reuse it. I'm going to use a tri-band antenna. So I'll be expecting delivery of a UDR56K to put on the site at some point in the future. From the site, go again. So looking from the site back across, that's the path. Now, I already know that I can do that path with D-Star. I've done it before. I took a picture. I did a paper here a couple of years ago where I did some testing of IPv6 and some DTN stuff over D-Star from that location to my house. So I know that works for over a D-Star to my vehicle. There's a mast there. It's actually it's a mast. It's a site that's on generator. We have keys to the site. We also know that it can see. Just going to go back. So this site here has line of sight to a digipeater, a site we're also in up here. So that gives us a pretty. That's the eastern side of the county. So Waterford County itself. This is the Cumber Mountains. It runs up the middle, and there's a good chunk of the county over here. But from here, between that site and this site, we can pretty much cover most of the county. The only place we can't cover is in here. There's a valley in there, the Nyre Valley. It's for public service events. It's one of our nightmare locations. I was saying to somebody yesterday, I think it was Eric maybe, I'm not sure if he's still here. The civil defense officer's nightmare is during August, we have a large bicycle event, about between 5,000 and 7,000 cyclists. But this cycle route here is actually a route they use, and they do two climbs over the mountain. But his nightmare is a bus meeting a peloton of cyclists in there, because comms is very difficult, very, very difficult in there. A lot of phone operators don't have coverage. Fire service don't have radio coverage. From an amateur point of view, we don't have any coverage in there. So what we do for that event is we send in two guys who do nothing else except set up an Envis HF station. They put up a 12-meter mast on a very specific location, and we know we can then, that's their job for the day, because that is his nightmare. And there's been a couple of close ones in there. Complete aside, there's a very, very steep descent here. And we've always had problems with it. 2 years ago, at the bottom corner, there's a sharp left turn. For years, we've had problems with cyclists crashing there. We couldn't get away, so we tried big signage, we tried guys with megaphones, nothing worked. Park an ambulance on the corner, everybody slows down. They come around the bend, they see this ambulance at the bottom of the hill, and everybody slows down. That was a complete aside. So the idea is we get a backbone. Another point. Civil Defense HQ building is in here. As I've been over here, there's now, a 70 meg internet connection in here. We have a 3 meg connection up to this site. Well, sorry, we haven't it in place yet, but we have the equipment to do it. That's plenty enough to service D-Star and the UDR56K. So the idea is we have a backbone in the county. Now, I don't know how many UDR56Ks we will need to cover the county, but based on the terrain and our pre-existing knowledge of repeater coverage in the area, we'd probably need a half dozen or so, which would give us a good, solid, low-bandwidth data communication facility around the county. And if I could do that, the CDO would love me. Any questions?
I just want to make a quick clarification. First off, thanks for that great work, because I love field data. You know, it's like we all talk about how this works, like take it out there, set it up, and try it. Just so everyone knows, when John refers to D-STAR, he's talking about D-STAR DD.
Yes, sorry.
Not the more common D-STAR DV, which is a D-STAR header and Ethernet behind it with no FEC whatsoever. The FEC is in the header, but it's not in the packet. So that's one of the things with discussions yesterday. That's an opportunity for us to do something better. And test platforms are, that's what it's all about. Get out there and try it and see what do we actually get. The bidirectional thing, that needs to be looked into because it defies common sense.
Yeah.
But, you know,
it could be
maybe there's something good there.
It could be an artifact from the DD mode. I have nothing to compare it against.
Yes.
I don't know. Yeah.
Thank you.
Hi, Alan Crossland, TYGK. Did you consider running UDP tests with iPerf just to get a baseline?
No, but in the past we used, when we did some DTN testing a couple of years ago over that same path, I used the norm convergence layer with DTN, which is UDP based, and flat out it'll do at 84 kilobits a second. It beats TCP hands down. Yeah, it absolutely does.
Yeah, I'm just wondering if the bidirectional had to do with TCP window sizes and ACKs being piggybacked on data and maybe short packets are being dropped and long ones aren't, things like that.
Yeah, I'm not sure. We have the TCP dumps, we just haven't had time to look at them. UDP doesn't work very well when you try, well, at least I could never get UDP to behave reliably when I tried to use UDP testing over D-STAR, over the DD mode. It could be just me. And the fact that I concentrated on the TCP stuff, because most things you want to use, such as email and browsing, all use TCP.
You might want to Google around, I don't remember exactly the bug, but there's a known bug with iPerf, where one of the command line parameters was ignored, depending on which version of iPerf you had.
Okay,
I learned this
enough.
The hard way doing some iPerf testing, so... And that, I think that affected UDP mode.
Okay, we didn't use it though. Before the next question, just to continue on what I was saying about the node. So the idea is, I mean, I don't know how many of you are familiar with DD mode. It's a bridge, it's an Ethernet bridge. So my idea for the node in Helvig Head is we have a DD mode radio. We use a UDR56K, well this is my idea, a UDR56K plugged into the Ethernet port. We run whatever mesh protocol we find, get to use basically on the UDR56K. That then will give us network over the DD radio as well. Probably going to have to plug in a USB to Ethernet adapter for any other connections. But the idea is the UDR56K will add intelligence to the DD mode radio and allow us to do other protocols over it. Because at the end of the day, it's just a dumb bridge. Question.
You mentioned that the ACKs were getting through better than the data packets.
That's our suspicion.
What I would suggest doing is maybe running a series of pings to look for loss at varying packet lengths. And the reason for doing that is your ACKs are likely shorter. And because the DD mode doesn't have FEC, what you're likely running into is the longer the packets are, the less likely they are to make it through without an error.
Yeah, yeah, and that's what I assume we're seeing because the situation is contrived to generate that actual, to make that happen, and that the two end nodes can't see one another. But on the problem is that I've no way of looking at the channel. All I can see is what the radio gives me. So it'd be much better if I could see the actual channel and what actually bits are on the channel, because then you could tell exactly what's happening. I don't have that kind of kit.
That makes perfect sense. It would be interesting to see maybe a graph of ping size versus, you know, probability of, or versus loss.
Yeah.
But that is, of course, frustrating with lots of networking gear that you can't see the raw channel and the raw bit errors.
Thank you very much, John.
No problem.